Welcome to everyone joining us today. I'm Michelle Darlington and I work with the Cambridge Judge Business School Centre for Social Innovation. And welcome to SHAPE Education. SHAPE is an initiative from Cambridge Assessment and the Cambridge Judge Business School. It's been running cross-sector events over the last 18 months, bringing people together to accelerate change in education. And I'm delighted to open this week of bite-sized events today. All of them are focusing on the future of schools. You'll find a full programme on the SHAPE website, and there's also a link in the chat. And if you can't stay for the whole event, a recording will be available at our website, shapeeducation.org. afterwards, and we'll be continuing the conversation in our SHAPE Education events channel on LinkedIn. If you're posting in our network, please do use the hashtag future of schools. And we have our graphic recorder, Rebecca Osborne, also drawing a live visual depiction of today's discussion, which we'll share afterwards on our website as well. So last year has taught us that we need to get better at imagining a range of possible futures as we think about the different scenarios the world might face and how those potential changes impact global education. What will schools look like? What will English language learning look like? Today, we're thinking more widely about society as we move forwards socially, economically, technologically, environmentally. What challenges, disruptions, and changes will we see in different regions of the world? What will shape how we live, work, and learn? So in the next hour, we hope to inspire and provoke discussion on this. So please do participate in the chat. We will be doing a poll, and please also share any questions that you have for our discussion in the Q&A section, and we'll come to those later in the session. So to start with, we have a question for all of our participants today, and please answer this in the Zoom chat. What do you think will be the biggest global challenge in the next 10 to 20 years? So let's have a look at the chat. Let's give everyone a minute to respond to that. Climate change, pollution, technology, equality, demographic transitions, digital unwellness. Of course, it's going so fast. Climate change, poverty. Hello from Mexico. Hi, Mexico. Social and class divide. De-schooling, that's an interesting one. Natural disaster, inequality, lack of clean water, complexity, access to broadband, integration of technology, mental well-being, AI and education, it's going to be a challenge. Health, F2F schooling, face-to-face schooling, yes. Peace, thanks, Matthew. Who's that? Matthew, thank you, Matthew. Quantum education system. I don't know what that means, but hopefully we can hear more about that in the chat. Yeah, please keep your responses coming in. And while you do, I would like to introduce our four panelists today. So we're delighted to be joined by Mauro Gielen. Mauro, do you want to just say hello so everyone can see you?
Hello, everybody. Good morning, good afternoon.
Hi, Mauro. So Mauro is the Dean of Cambridge Judge Business School and a Fellow of Queen's College. Mauro designed an award-winning curriculum as Director of the Lauder Institute at the University of Pennsylvania. He was also a member of the University of Oviedo's basketball team, which won the Spain's National College Championship in 1987. 3 years after he passed the first certificate in English and his certificate of proficiency in English from Cambridge Assessment. That's right. Mauro's research on globalization, multinational corporations, and digital platforms has been translated into 20 languages. And his recent book, 2030, has important insights for us at Shape. And I just finished reading it yesterday. Mauro, I got to the end. So I'm very excited to discuss the ideas in it with you today. Our second panelist is Neil Gibb. Neil, do you want to say hello?
Yeah, hi, I'm Neil Gibb. I've just heard that Mauro's into basketball, so he must be quite tall. I'm quite tall too, so that's the main thing to know about me at the moment.
You can't tell on Zoom. Neil is a social innovator and a business consultant. Neil also has a book, his best-selling book, Participation Revolution, explains how we're seeing a radical change from consumer to social economics. Neil is the co-founder of the 21st Century Leadership Project, and he's also the founder of the South Lanes Project, which is a social experiment in Essex. And responding to our two presenters, we have a great panel of two. We have Glenn Ledbetter. Say hi, Glenn.
Hi, everybody. How are you doing?
Hi, Glenn. Glenn will also be joining our Friday session on the future of English language learning. Glenn started his teaching career in New Zealand before moving to Japan, where he's been working as the director of studies for the Japan International Education Center in Tokyo, where he created ESL curricula and textbooks that were focusing on embedding inquiry-based learning and kind of student-centered principles into ESL. And Glenn is now head of ESL at CLASS, which is a Japanese school based in Switzerland, where he continues to develop inquiry-led and student-centered teaching methods. So we're quite interested in that, teaching Japanese students English in Switzerland. It's be interesting. And last but not least, we have Tioka Dove. Tioka, do you want to say hello?
Hi, everyone. Good afternoon.
Hi, Tioka. So Tioka is joining us from Trinidad. And Tioka is a development strategist. She is also a consultant for international development organizations, including the Caribbean Development Bank. And Tioka currently works with GmbH, where she is the communication and visibility advisor for the Technical Assistance Program for Sustainable Energy in the Caribbean. Tioka is also a student of the Cambridge Judd Business School's Masters in Social Innovation. We're very lucky to have her on the program. Tioka has been really active in the voluntary sector, especially around youth development programs, which is one of the reasons why we wanted to have her on the panel today. She's also the founder of her own foundation, the Tioka Dove Foundation, which is dedicated to improving the quality of life of economically and socially vulnerable people through social entrepreneurship, vocational training, employment scholarships, and financial assistance. So thank you all of you for joining us today for the panel. And please do respond in the chat as we go. And without further ado, I'm going to hand over to Mauro for your lightning talk. So thank you, Mauro.
Oh, thank you so much, Michelle, for organizing this event. Thank you, everybody on the team. And welcome, everyone. I would like to essentially spend my 10 minutes of fame this morning or afternoon telling you about how I see the world of education evolving as a result of some very, very large scale transformations that we see in the world at the intersection of three types of trends. Okay, so one type of trend is population demography. A second one is what's going on with the economy. And then the third one is technological change. Okay, so let me bring to your attention like a number of things that I think are really, really important for us educators to keep in mind for the next 5 to 10 years. So the first is, as you know, women have over the last few decades in some parts of the world, but not all parts of the world, gain much, much better access to education. To the point that, for example, in the United States, there's more women now in college than there are men. Now, the most important implication of this change, once again, which is still in progress because not everywhere in the world women have equal access to education when compared to men, but the big consequence of this is a decline in the number of babies being born. And so I think one of the most important features of the education sector, broadly speaking, over the next few years and decades is going to be that each generation, younger generation of people in most parts of the world is going to be smaller than the preceding one. And that's why we see so many schools shutting down in some parts of the world, because there's simply not enough children, right? In China, for example, just listen to this fact. In China, between now and the end of the decade, so for the next 9 years, there's going to be 110 million fewer young people, 110 fewer young people in school. That's 110 million. That's a lot of people, right? Imagine how many classrooms are no longer going to be needed in China. Now, at the same time, the second big change is going to be what happens in sub-Saharan Africa. Because in sub-Saharan Africa, although the number of babies per woman continues to go down, it is still at a level of about 4 or 4.1 per woman. And so this means that over the next 10 years, about 450 million babies will be born in sub-Saharan Africa. So that's 450 million babies. There's not enough schools in sub-Saharan Africa to cater to the needs of that growing population. And I think this is going to be really important to tackle, because in sub-Saharan Africa, we can either have a lost generation of children over the next 10 years, or we can have a highly educated generation of children. I personally believe that the only way to make sure that all of those babies over the next 20 years in Africa are schooled is to use technology. The same way that Africa has pioneered mobile payments and also mobile health, because of lack of a pre-existing infrastructure of banking or healthcare, I strongly believe that something similar may have to happen with education. And again, I'm sure some of you are thinking, well, but that's not gonna be as good as having those children in a classroom with a teacher. But consider the alternative. The alternative is that tens of millions of those babies may go unschooled in sub-Saharan Africa. And I don't think that's good for Africa. I don't think that's good for the world. So there's a challenge there, but there's also an opportunity, I think, to deploy some of the technologies that we have developed over the last 18 months and try to make the best out of a situation that out of necessity will be challenging. But for me, the biggest change is going to happen in developed parts of the world, like in Europe or United States, Canada, Australia, Japan, and also in some of the emerging markets where the knowledge economy is growing really fast, like in China. And this is what I see. What I see is first that people are living longer and longer and longer. So as you know, today in Europe, somebody who celebrates his, her, or they, or their 60th birthday have another 25 years of life ahead. 25 years, that's another lifetime. That's a big change. Another big change is that those people who are celebrating today their 60th birthday are in much better physical and mental shape than people celebrating the same birthday 20 years ago or 30 years ago. So in other words, not only the lifespan has increased, but also our health span has increased. Okay, so we remain in much better physical and mental shape for longer. And then the third thing is technological change. So technological change is having a huge impact on the labor market. And the biggest impact that it's having is that whatever it is that workers or many workers have learned becomes obsolete or becomes antiquated much faster than in the past. So if you put all of those three trends together, then this is my forecast for what I think is going to happen in the world of education over the next 5 to 10 years. I think we're going to be seeing increasingly big numbers of people who are going to go to school not only once in their lives, but they're going to go several times to school. Why do I say that? Okay, so now we go to school when we are teenagers, when we are in our early 20s, perhaps we go to university. But increasingly so, when people turn 40, they realize that whatever it is that they learn at school is no longer as useful to them in the labor market. So I think those people are going to go back to school. And don't get me wrong, I'm not saying that people will go back into the college room or a dorm. Okay, what I'm saying is that perhaps a very large numbers of people are going to be using digital platforms such as the one that we're using right now to go back to school. And then they will continue to work. But then they will turn 60 at some point, and they will realize that they still have 25 years ahead of them. They will also realize that whatever money they have saved is not enough for 25 years worth of retirement. And they'll also realize that whatever they learned or relearned by age 40 is no longer as useful because of technological change. So they will go back to school, and then they will go back to work. Now, two other points here. First, if people go back to school a couple of times, in addition to the initial one over their lifetimes, there's nothing preventing them from pursuing a different career or profession or occupation. So we're already seeing this a little bit. But I think in the near future, next 5 to 10 years, we're going to see millions and millions of people switching careers. And by the way, I think that's going to be great in terms of them being able to adapt or to adjust to changes in the global economy. Because the global economy is going to continue to evolve and create different kinds of jobs as time goes by. And then lastly, one other, I think, really important issue here that I would like to as well put on the table. I'm trying to persuade you that people are going to go back to school several times at different levels of education. What I think is going to be really important is that we help people not just learn new things, but also unlearn things that maybe now technology has made obsolete. Because oftentimes companies, they say, oh, we don't want to hire workers with a lot of experience in our industry because they learn the old ways and we have a new way of organizing work. This is why, for example, when the Japanese automobile companies such as Toyota or Honda first set up their operations in North America in the 1980s, they refused to hire any workers that had experience in the automobile industry. And the reason was that they wanted to come into the job with a fresh mind, and they wanted to train them according to the Japanese methods of shop floor organization. So just, Michelle, as a summary of what I've been trying to convey here, I think demographic changes are so big that they're gonna transform the education landscape over the next 5 to 10 years. We have fewer young people in the world. We have more people above the age of 40 or 50, 60, 70. Because of technological change, those people will need education, access to education once again in their lifetime, perhaps even a couple of times. And last point, it's all about learning new things, but also unlearning old, obsolete, antiquated ways of doing. So I think education in the future will need to do both. Help people learn and also help people unlearn. Thank you so much for your attention.
Thank you, Mauro. Thank you. Yes, yeah, so big demographic changes are coming. Fewer young people going to school in the global north, a lot more young people needing to be educated in the global south, and also a greater need for lifelong learning, which is going to bring the need for different models of education. I can see tons of comments in the chat from people who are really agreeing with this and saying, you know, they're May says she's 50 going back to school, and lots of comments about online platforms, Coursera, edX, and how, yeah, digital is going to be a big part of that transformation. So we are going to come back to this chat in the panel, but first of all, we would like to hand over to Neil. Hi, Neil. Thanks very much. Neil, are you muted?
There we are, already having a technical challenge, the challenge of these platforms. Yeah, hello, my name's Neil Gibb, and I'm very, very happy to be here. I haven't talked to Maro, but I think what I'm going to talk about will segue nicely with what he said. I'm going to get a bit more granular about it. So how will societies across the globe change the next 20 years in the context of education? The wonderful thing about the internet is the information is always changing. So it's a little bit more context for me. From Michelle was giving information from a few years ago. So I do run a company called Where To From Here. We're a company that helps other companies look at the future and more crucially make the steps and changes they need to navigate towards those futures. So I'm going to share a little bit of our insight from that. Whoops. Bit of context. I wrote this book a few years ago called The Participation Revolution, and what I'll be talking about builds on that. As a little quote from Neil Stott at Cambridge Business School, who was quite sort of keen on some of the ideas that led me to do some content development teaching in the Centre of Social Innovation. And this is a module I was doing on digital social innovation. And the reason I wanted to share that is you'll see in the background there's a picture, there's a curve. And really this is a contextual model, you know, I use in my work, which is that we're in the middle of this great transformation, you know, a structural shift in our economies, our societies, you know, on par with the Renaissance and the Industrial Revolution, but bigger because of all the things that Mara talked about. You know, we've got bigger challenges, we've got more people, the technology is more incredible, basically. And really in terms of the journey, there's these three stages, you know, it starts with a new tech, in the middle you have this period of massive disruption, and that is where we are. And eventually you have the emergence of some kind of new sort of society. Now, when you see that in the 19th century, the sort of start of the 19th century was very disruptive. By the end, all these amazing new things that we couldn't have imagined and emerged. So that's really what we're trying to talk about is where are we going with all this? And so for me, I think this quote from Jack Ma is really good. Jack Ma, you know, the CEO and founder of Alibaba, you know, the Amazon of China. Or he likes to say that Amazon is the Alibaba of the West. There's no experts of tomorrow. There are only experts of yesterday. And I think that's an important point when you're looking at the future, because the problem with the future, the problem with futurism is this. And I said, there's always a hoverboard. You know, if you, this is from Back to the Future. You know, when we project into the future, we create these fantastical landscapes often with this beautiful, wonderful, quite often utopian technology, or we go dystopian, you know, we create these kind of views. Now, I should say, although there's always a hoverboard, there may be a hoverboard in this future, because I saw this picture the other day, which is Mark Zuckerberg. This was on his Instagram on the July the 4th, Independence Day. And this is a little video, it's worth seeing, but there is Mark on a hoverboard. So there may actually be hoverboards in the future. But really what I want to say is, this is a quote from William Gibson, who you know, was a great sort of science fiction writer. And he said, the future is already here. It's just not very evenly distributed. And that's what I'm going to be talking about today. Not projecting wildly into how I see the future, but what's happening now, which is emergent, which will probably impact the future or expand into the future that we're talking about. So that's really what we do. We call this foresight, and we call this speculative future. So I'm just going to share a few from what we've seen, which is going to be relevant to this conversation. So really sort of three frames I'm going to look at. The first is accelerating systemic change. And you know, here's a quote that often gets quoted to Darwin. It's not the strongest of the species that survives, nor the most intelligent. It's the one most adaptable to change. And this quote in itself shows the problem at the moment, you know, with the internet, right? Is this is often attributed to Darwin, but it was a guy called Professor Leon Messenson, the Louisa State University in 1963, who was summarizing Darwin, right? So it is kind of Darwinian thinking. So if you look at that kind of that curve, this is a dirty kind of diagram I did on a board, you know, we're going through these three phases, right? We can understand the technology, we understand the background of the technology, we understand and really feel keenly everything that's happening to us at the moment. But in terms of where we're going, it's a lot less clear. So really, one of the skills that we really need to develop, particularly for young people, the skills we will need to develop are not how can we stop, how can we arrest, how can we roll back change. And often older people want to do that. They don't like things to change. But it's how to adapt. We need to teach adaption, the ability to navigate change, the ability to see opportunities in a volatile and emerging world. And I think that's a key educational kind of trait that we need to kind of focus on. And particularly this, you know, we've had a few years in schools where we focus very much on the psychological, mental, and emotional well-being of our children. And that's fantastic. But often that, you know, at the cost of resilience. And as we move into a difficult kind of phase, the question is going to be, how do we do this? You know, all things are difficult before they're made easy. How do we help people kind of navigate this very complex environment? So the second thing is what I call the digitization of everything. You know, we talk about digitization like it's a separate thing, but digitization in the same way that mechanization in the 19th century mechanized everything, digitization is just going to become part of the fabric. It already has become part of the fabric of our lives. You know, little quote from Bloomberg this week, it said, fired by a bot, Amazon turns to machine managers and workers are losing out. You know, so we're seeing the convergence of technology. We're going to see the algorithms and machinery doing a lot of human tasks in the future, which obviously needs to change what we need to do in terms of educating people. And a critical thing is the commoditization of knowledge. And this is the thing which is disrupting the education system, because the education system has been based on knowledge. Intellectual property, knowledge, and the dissemination of knowledge. But now if you type into that box at the moment at the bottom, most of that knowledge is available. So three things that we're seeing in terms of education. The shift to praxis in terms of value from learning information to learning how to do. And here is a great example of that. This is Fender Play, the guitar company, who's changing its business model from making guitars and selling guitars. It still does that, but an awful lot of people have bought those guitars now, to actually, how do we teach people to play those guitars? And there, you know, there is a small niche education platform, which shifts to another thing that we're seeing, which is the creation of hyper niche. And here's an example of that. This is one of my clients, the UX Design Institute, based in Dublin, who are a specialist educational provider online, but augmented with real world support, very, very customer centric, who focus just on UX design, you know, and they're growing incredibly, you know, like 100% a year over the last 5 years, you know. And what we're seeing here is the emergence of these kind of niche ecosystems. And I'm not going to go into much detail into this other than to say, you know, what we're seeing with these niche companies is they're owning a space. So in terms of UX design, the UX Design Institute owns this space, and we're getting these ecosystems that has recruiters, employers and institutes in this kind of very tight kind of virtuous circle. It's very attractive when Mara's talking about lifelong learning. You can do a 6-month program with them, which will take you from knowing nothing to being very highly skilled in this space. And then thirdly, I'm not going to say much about this, but alt.education, of course, online allows anybody to get online. Here's an example of someone called Zach Bush, who is a doctor, who is also an anti-vaxxer, who has this massive following. So we're beginning to see new channels and different kind of views on education emerging as well. And then the third thing I'm going to talk about, whoops, I'm missing a slide, is the emergence of what I'm going to call the metaverse. And I'm not going to go into this too much, but I think this is the big issue in terms of what's going to happen over the next 10 to 20 years. So backdrop to that, you know, what is the biggest issue I think we're dealing with? I'm going to call it surveillance capitalism. So here's something that looks like a game. This is a screen from an airport. This is face recognition and body print movement recognition going on in an airport. So you can actually find out who's going through the airport at any one time. Here's Amazon Go, the new Amazon store, which allows you to go in, buy something and walk out without having to go to a till. It will automatically credit your debit your account based on these things. The ceiling is completely covered in cameras, motion cameras, which is actually looking at what you're doing, working out who you are from your face and through your body printing. So we're seeing surveillance everywhere. We've now got these in our homes, listening to everything we do. And we got these on our wrists, recording our biometrics, you know. So slowly but surely, you know, we're creating this massive pool of data about who we are. And one of the responses to this, and this is from the New York Fashion Week, is what we're seeing in fashion is covering up. And I think this is going to be the big trend over the next 10 years is the opening of the world that the internet gave us to the closing. We're seeing people moving off open platforms onto closed platforms. We're going to see people covering up. We're going to see the idea of people wanting to keep their identity and their privacy very, very much to themselves. So the flip side of that is this thing called the metaverse. And so very simply, if you don't know what that word means, this is the connecting up of all the different kind of parts of the internet, particularly the virtual spaces. A lot of it's emerged out of gaming. And here's an example of that. This is from League of Legends. This is just a game, but let's put that in context. This is just a game that 200 million people play every month. And at any one time, about 10 to 15 million people are playing together. And here we see a screen from it. But what's interesting, if you look around the bottom, that's Louis Vuitton branding. So we're seeing the real world going into the virtual world. And then we're seeing the virtual world going into the real world. This is a Louis Vuitton League of Legends real world products that you can buy. And again, we're seeing here Gucci doing the same. And an interesting quote from Forbes magazine that in one of these games, Gucci dropped a limited edition bag, a virtual bag. It's not a real bag, right? A virtual bag, and it sold for $4,115, which is actually more than the retail value of the real bag. It's kind of weird, right? But in terms of gaming, in terms of young people, these are the spaces that they're operating in, and this is spaces that education can be, needs to start to think about, because we're seeing the emergence of avatars. So where people are covering up in the real world, they're creating characters, virtual characters that are operating in this kind of space. And then that moves us to this interesting idea, which is from Minecraft, which is the UNESCO World Heritage Contest. We're actually seeing, you know, students being allowed to actually go and rebuild parts of and imagine parts of the world, you know. So it's a beautiful, very, very playful way of solving some of the world's kind of big problems. And then I'll just finish up here, which is emerging out of this is what we're calling the creator economy, the third generation of the web. We went from information, we went from to social to the creator economy, where now people who actually create on the web are being monetized. There's a platform here called OnlyFans. Like an awful lot of technology at the moment, it mainly seems to be driving pornography and sex workers. But the point of this is it's a platform that allows you to build your own kind of community, and in that monetize what you do. So it's taking out all the other institutions in the supply chain. At the same time, we're seeing the blockchain, and we're seeing something called NFTs, which is very, very fashionable at the moment, allowing people to do the same with content. And here's an example of someone who recently sold some virtual art, so their art for $69 million on the internet via the blockchain, right? And I'll leave you with this example because this is very pertinent to me. You know, I wrote this book called The Participation Revolution. It was technically a bestseller. It didn't sell many copies though, because people aren't actually buying that many copies. It certainly didn't make me much money. Some people asked me if I could take some of the content and do a how-to guide, which is on the right-hand side, just as an experiment. I created an NFT out of that and started selling it. I made an awful lot more money out of doing that than I did out of the first one. And so that's a work in progress for me. So where to from here? In terms of all the things we've talked about. So I think this is another Jack Ma quote. He says, the machines of the future, I can't actually read my quote. I'm going to leave you with that one. So there's a quote from Jack Ma, but the point is he's saying, the machines are gonna be doing the intellectual heavy lifting, but what we have is we have the heart. So I think in terms of education, at the moment, there's a lot of focus on technology, but as that technology becomes automated, it's going to be the heart, it's going to be the arts that become more important. How do we build relationships? How do we solve problems in communities? How do we collaborate together? Those are going to be the interesting, those are going to be the value adds, if you're right, that human bring to society. So the machines may be digital, but humans are analog. And I'll leave it there. Thank you.
Wow. Thanks for that, Neil. There's been quite a few responses in the chat, and I think, yeah, the points that you're raising about, you know, the commodification of knowledge and how that's going to be challenged by digital channels and digital learning channels, it's going to really kind of disrupt educational models and also business models for education. Know that Tioka might respond to that from her perspective, but I'd like to turn to Glenn first, because there's also a lot of comments coming through the chat about, you know, how can teachers keep up? And, you know, if it's the heart that's important, then how can we make sure that our students can thrive in this new and actually quite scary reality in parts? What do they need to unlearn to respond to Mauro? And yeah, I think, Glenn, I think this is something that you've given a lot of thought and attention to. So, yeah, what kind of learning environment does this need?
Yeah, absolutely. I think the whole point of the unlearning is really, really important, especially older generation. We kind of get stuck in our ways. And I know a lot of teachers who do get stuck in a way that I've done this for 20 years and this is the way I'm doing it. And we need to break free of that and start to look at much more of a way of teaching the students to be much more flexible, much more creative in the way they approach education. The whole idea of knowledge versus doing, the idea that knowledge is worth more, I believe it's more like, how do you research? How can you look at knowledge, because knowledge is very easy to find these days. We can go online very, very quickly, but it's teaching the kids, teaching everybody to actually be able to look at the information and be able to judge it for what it is. Is this actually real news or fake news, or is this information? The whole idea that the internet came about as democracy of knowledge. Now anybody can actually go ahead and write something. So it's teaching the kids to be much more critical in the way they're looking at things, teaching students to be able to research and be critical, and actually not just look at things for the sake of learning.
And Glenn, what do you think are the challenges that teachers will face who are trying to do this? From your experience, what have been the obstacles that you've encountered?
I think some of the big challenges is actually the reluctance of some political situations, where they're reluctant to change, and also reluctance from some school institutions to actually change. I find that actually there's a lot of teachers who are willing to change and want to push forward, but often there is a holdback due to certain ways of testing, ways of looking at examinations that kind of hold teachers into a much more rigid framework that don't allow them to push through into being more modern. I thought the idea with Minecraft, which Neil was talking about, I use that in my class to let the kids be creative and create situations that they can kind of look at and look at things in different ways and create 3D models themselves. I thought, there's a lot of stuff which we are stuck by because you are buying a textbook that this is the government official textbook that says this is what you must teach, and it's not taking into account the students' motivation, their intrinsic or extrinsic motivation. That's not really taking into account, just being creative. It's putting them more into a box, and I feel that's limiting them.
Thank you, Glenn. Yeah, I'd like to throw this over to Teoka, but before I do, just to think about how, a lot of parents are really going out of their way to, to send their children to your school and actually paying a lot of money. and that's a good sign that, children and parents really want to learn in this way and they value it. But what would this look like, in the global South? And I think we have to really think about these two challenges at the same time. What would a sort of minimum viable product for education look like, given all of the disruption that that Maro and Neil have outlined? And so I'd like to call on Teoka to give us your perspective from over there in the Caribbean. How's the weather, by the way?
It's sunny outside.
First of all.
Yeah, it's sunny outside. I'm hearing the discussion and I wondered, first of all, it's totally correct. And much of what you would have explained, Mario and Neil, I have had as in my own personal experience of every 3 years upskilling and pivoting and changing careers, because that's generally how Gen Zs and millennials are. Whereas our parents, they got educated and they stayed in one job for, 30 years until they retire. For us, we're always looking for something new and dynamic. So every 3 years or every 5 years, we look at another role or something new to get that challenge. But in the Caribbean, I'm listening to the conversation and I'm wondering if this is the future, then we're way behind, and I'll tell you why. In the region, there were already challenges before the pandemic. Yeah, so we had Hurricane Maria, Hurricane Irma, and a number of these hurricanes that would have deeply affected our countries due to climate change, would have deeply affected our countries, eradicated housing stock, hotel stock, agriculture stock, and so forth. And as we were building back, when those things are eradicated, families, are disrupted, lives are disrupted. And as many of our regional brothers and sisters were building back, the pandemic came. And because many of these economies are now focused on, again, tourism, in many cases, because there are no natural resources, with countries' borders closed and the pandemic, we again had to use all our resources to put into keeping countries afloat, borrowing or using resources, whatever was there to keep countries afloat. What happened is, and I speak now in terms of my country in Trinidad and Tobago and many other countries in the region, you had children who are now in their second academic year and have not seen a physical school or physical teachers yet. They've all been online, yeah, because of the pandemic. So since March 2020, children in Trinidad and Tobago have not been in a physical school. They've all been online. But guess what? About 20% of those children who were already on the fringe of society, meaning they came from vulnerable communities, rural communities, communities without access to energy, they never came online. They've lost 2 years of their life and their livelihood in school. These children were already at the fringe of society, meaning they're from vulnerable households and communities. And so while education inequality has now increased, for the future, we now have to look at income inequality. Yeah, because these children are now behind. There's no telling if they would go back to school or if they can't catch up or if they will just move along a system, missing that those years and months of learning. And as such, when we speak about the future, if they don't have access to energy, they can't if they don't have access to energy or even technology, then they can't access that online learning. So how do we really equal the playing field when there are so many in the global south who do not have the basic access to the resource that is energy and technology? Yeah. And more importantly, there is no resources. And that's why I went to what happened to our region before. There are very little resources in this term of building back better that we can invest in social development, because much of it has to go to keep the countries afloat. So my question is, how do we in the region survive all of this? Yeah, because as I speak to you, we are in the most active hurricane season. Yeah, and it has just commenced. And we went to bed one night with a tropical storm in this region 2 weeks ago. And we got up with a category one hurricane that knocked power out in a country like Barbados for about 4 days. And those children who were preparing for their most important exams, which we call, you may think GCE is the equivalent in the UK, but CXE in the Caribbean, they had no power, some of them in across Barbados, St. Lucia, Grenada, but mostly in Barbados that was affected, for about 4 days leading up to that exam. Yeah, so I wanna bring the discussion, and it's a beautiful discussion, but I know I sit here from a place of privilege because I have access to talk to you through this screen. And there's so many children who just have no access. So when we think about, and you started off with a question, Michelle, when we think about what's the biggest thing that's going to happen in the next few years that's going to disrupt, that's going to affect us? Education inequality, tied into income inequality, tied into long-term poverty, and a simple section of our population, the most important part, our human capital, not having the opportunity to advance themselves. Pushed back now further, for the first time in 20 years, we've seen an increase in poverty when we are on a decline. So we're all going with these SDGs to 2030, but much of what we have worked for in the last 20 years have been eradicated. So are we really reaching our goal in 2030? And what are we going to do for those who were vulnerable and at risk then in terms of education and all of these different bits? What are we gonna do now? Where 150 million more people, as per the World Bank data, has now been pushed into poverty. So think about those who are already in poverty. Yeah, so that's where I wanna center my thoughts and my contribution as we have this discussion, that we're still talking from a place of, we have access at some point. And there are millions around the world without access, and who will not. It will take policy shift, resources to get access to energy. It will take innovation to get access to energy to communities, to get learning that is shaped and unique to the indigenous experience, and not pushing and putting young people in this box that, okay, this is what education looks like, because the world is changing. But many countries in the global south do not have the resources to advance the education system. There isn't the political will and the opportunity to pivot and really change education policy to get where it needs to be. So what happens? We become wild, as Maria said. We will have much of the larger, younger population. Are they fit in the majority of them for work in the fields and in the occupations and in the spheres that will exist in the future?
Thank you, Tioka. Yeah, so I'm hearing two things from you. One is the importance of open access for you know, education more broadly, and how that can be a leveler. But at the same time, the impact of the pandemic has exacerbated the existing trend towards educational and therefore also economic inequality. And yes, that's happening in you know, in the global south. It's also happening to a lesser extent in the global north as well. Even in the UK, we're seeing that the pandemic has caused a greater divide in educational inequality. And there's a lot of comments in the chat, people who are really echoing that. In Mauritius, they're seeing the same thing, and lots of comments about blended education. And I'd like to call on Mauro to also respond to this, because I believe it's something that you've also given some thought to.
Which question about blended?
About, yeah, I mean, open access and blended learning, but also, yeah, you know, inequality, global inequality is increasing.
Yeah.
How might we
look? I couldn't agree more with Tioka Dove, and forgive me if I'm not pronouncing your name correctly, in that the technology is right now in the world, technological change, the single most important contributor to inequality. So every research, every study that I've seen essentially says that technological change, because it's unevenly distributed, because some people take more advantage of it than others, it's a major source of inequality. But I think that technology can also be part of the solution, not just part of the problem. And that's where I think blended comes in, right? So I think we've learned as educators over the last 18 months that remote learning is not necessarily a second best, but there's also disadvantages to it, especially with younger children. So my sense is that we are moving into a future of blended education, where we're going to be cherry picking the good things about in-classroom education and combining them with the good things about remote learning. But always, of course, you know, under the assumption that we have a crash program to essentially make Wi-Fi and make the necessary equipment available. And by the way, it doesn't stop at that. It's also that for some households, they don't have enough space in the home for all the children to actually be able to work and study, right? So it's not just that the Wi-Fi or the computer or the tablet, it's also that they don't have appropriate space enough space in the home, let's say for 3 or 4 children to be able to learn from the home. So yes, I mean, we need to work on all of those things, but at the same time, we also, I think, need to seize the opportunity to reinvent education, to make it better by incorporating technology.
Thank you, Mauro. Yeah, we have quite a few posts in the chat that are also indicating the need for, you know, political and policy shifts, and also shifts such as renewables, which Tioka, I know is something that you're thinking about for your region as well, renewable energy. I don't know if you want to respond to that question briefly before we continue. Yes, and we have a message here from Andrew, who says, we need cheap energy like hydrogen or renewables that are being blocked by vested interests like oil companies.
That's correct. So there was a question that my team lead asked recently, because we're doing basically what TAPSEC is that we are working to implement the CARICOM energy policy, which is really focused on transitioning the Caribbean to a sustainable climate resilient region. But while that is happening, and of course that would support access to energy to rural communities, indigenous communities, but also a clean source of energy for the region. Again, we see where in the region countries are now exploring for oil and gas. So it feels like, and my boss asked the question, is the work that we're doing counterproductive? And I had to tell him, no, it's not. Because whereas we see this advancement and this need for renewable energy, the reason countries are still in the region looking and exploring for oil and gas is because they have to find other means of resources. Yeah. And as such, that is what many countries in our sense have to do to really sort of balance, how do we balance these budgets moving forward? So in every aspect, when we go to indigenous communities in Guyana, there is, you see children are still without access to energy, going to school without access to energy. And they then have to stop school at particular times when they're impacted by climate change or when there are floods in their region. So what I really think is collectively, we have to look at, and this has me worried, and I know I'm going on a bit, but I look at, for the first time, and this is when, again, I come back to, we're talking about 2030. For the first time, where countries in the global south would look to countries in the global north for support via development aid and so forth, all of us experienced the pandemic together. You see, the UK has decreased their aid budget. Same thing with the US and many countries around the world, because they now have to focus inward on their own communities and their own countries. And I'm wondering, what would support or development for the global south look like in the future, moving forward, post-pandemic, when we all experience this on all our budgets, when they say, we all experience the same financial and economic challenges, there's no real support that's coming, yeah? So how do we really mobilize? And again, I agree with Mario that technology is key and it's the driving force. But how do we, and this is my question to the panel, how do we drive this when there are no resources to do such? And more importantly, when every time we take two steps forward, like in regions that are affected by climate change, a hydrometeorological event comes and then eradicates everything that we do. And we have to start over again every 2 years. How do we do that?
Okay. Thanks, Tioka. That's an excellent question. And I think it's good that we have you and Glenn together on the panel, because I think, yes, there's a technological aspect to this, and that has to be part of the solution. As Mauro says, it's not only the problem, it's also the solution. But I'm also thinking about what's happened with the pandemic is not only that we've been doing much more digital learning, there's also been a lot more homeschooling. And we have a comment here from Natalie in the chat. She says, as a home educating mum of 2, 10, and 13-year-old kids, she finds the combination of digital and in-class better because she can cater the education to each child. And that's actually better and more convenient in some ways. So I think it's making me wonder, what would it look like for, you know, parents who maybe have none or intermittent access to the internet, to be implementing some of Glenn's wonderful teaching methods. And yeah, Glenn, how would you advise parents who are homeschooling? How can they find out how to do it better? Because a lot of people have hated it, let's be frank, homeschooling.
I mean, yeah, I think it was a real problem for a lot of people. And I know from discussions with parents, discussions with teachers, that it was a real problem to create a learning environment. You know, where could students study? Could they study? Did they have a safe place to study? And I think it's so varied, and there's no one answer to that. And I think like the whole idea of blended learning is great if that's what it is, but it creates such a gap You know, economically, those kids who don't have the access to the internet, even some of our kids who are quite, you know, well off, were struggling to actually be involved. And I think parents finding time to actually be with their kids. I had some students who were at home alone the whole time, and it really showed that motivation. If the kids were actually educationally motivated, they were happy to get on. If the parents were educationally motivated, then they were happy to help out. But some of those parents who didn't know where to go and didn't know how to deal with it, you can see the real drop in where they are. Finding resources, there are a few out there, and I think I can't really ask too much. It's not perfectly my specialty, but I think taking the time to kind of work with the kids and find what motivates them, and then create that motivation with them to create it to be relevant, make it to be interesting. I find we talk a lot about technology, but I see the kids, and I've worked with students for many years, technology can sometimes actually be detrimental, where they can get quite, students who are put in front of a computer, okay, now study. And they're like, oh yeah, that's cool. Switch it over. They're on online chatting with their mates, YouTube, going down a tunnel that way. So there are situations where you need to take technology, but in limited parts that are positive and actually useful. Otherwise, it can just become a distraction and not be useful at all.
Yeah, thanks, Glenn. I think you've hit on some really important points there about, you know, finding motivation to learn can also be about learning together with your family and having that shared learning experience, which I think is often missing when we learn one-to-one in front of a screen. We only have a few minutes left, but I'd like to call on Neil to have the closing. So Neil, what are your thoughts on this kind of the need to balance between, you know, the digital and human sides of these challenges?
Well, as I said, I think, you know, we're talking about the digitization of everything ultimately. And to the point we'll stop talking about digital, like, you know, this is a digital experience, but this has really got nothing to do with, you know, we're just talking to each other, right? It's enabling conversations. I think Tioca talked about something which is vital, which is about the infrastructure. If we rely on this technology, particularly when you're in areas which have lots of challenges, to be able to rely on the infrastructure is important. So that is like a hierarchy of needs. The oil and gas industry, I think, is, I don't want to get too much into that, but there's pretty much a lot of the world's challenges have been because of the fossil fuel industry. And I do think that the renewable shift is going to change the geopolitical landscape. So I'm not going to go into that at all. So actually, really, I think the thing to talk about that I'm interested in, I've moved to Bradford in West Yorkshire, near where I come from. It's an area with an awful lot of interesting social challenges. I'm particularly interested in the access to work and education for working class people. And it seems to me that the solution to that is actually a lot to do with parents, you know, is actually because things are changing so quickly. So I think the educational journey isn't about teaching children, it's about teaching children and their parents and including them in the conversation. That's certainly the thing I'm interested in at the moment.
Thank you. Thank you, Neil. And thanks to all of our panelists and for everybody who's contributing to the chat. I think that we're going to continue talking about these themes throughout the week. And I'm really glad that we've kicked this off. So yes, thanks again to all of our panelists. I'm afraid that's all we have time for today. But please join us tomorrow for the rest of the conversation, and also look at our events channel, Shape Education Events on LinkedIn, where we'll be continuing this discussion. There's also going to be a report that we will publish that brings together all these insights, and of course, Rebecca's fantastic graphic recording of the session. So do look out for those. Yeah, thanks for joining everyone.